Hey, Coach Jarvis, you are entering your fourth season as head coach of the Blue Devils. What lessons have you learned so far that you can implement into this one?
You know, it's fourth year, like you said. So these are my kids. Our senior class started with me, so they're our kids. And one thing I learned in my previous coaching job and here, there's no fast forward button. You've got to just work hard and it takes a little bit of time. We grabbed a lot of momentum last year in this offseason. Our kids have been phenomenal and in regard to their work ethic and taking on the personality of our coaches and just a joy to be around. But it takes time, and that's not a negative statement. It just takes time and with your kids and just them being familiarity with us. And even we just came back from camp this past week and just our offense is installed, you know, where our first couple of years would be a few games into the season holding stuff back, you know, that you just would have been too much at that time. So that part of it in the fourth year, just with the kids really familiar with us coaches and vice versa, just and I love this as a coach, the routine, the kids being very comfortable with us and us with them as well.
And so you mentioned how the spring and summer have kind of been evolving for you. Let me get into your schedule. And You're in Region 8, single A D1, for those that don't know, and it is a mini region, M-I-N-I, and I mean that literally, because it's only four of you, which means that You and the schedule maker have to have some serious conversations about your non-region schedule. When you look at how hard is it to piece together a schedule when you've got to come up with seven non-region opponents?
John, that's an excellent question. And I said this to a lot of people last year. You know, when I was in 7A, I didn't really have strong opinions about classifications and who, because we kind of knew we were in the regions we were and who you were playing. Well, you get in the lower classifications like we are in single A, and they gave us our schedule, and here I am scrambling for seven games. Getting those games in week six and seven may have been the hardest thing I've done in coaching as far as trying to put it all together. And truthfully, it wasn't about whether you wanted to play somebody or not. It was you would take anybody to play. And so we've got a couple of trips into Atlanta, which is fine. But our schedule, you know, our first couple of weeks, we scrimmage Stevens County, we play Hart County, we play Madison County. You know, those are AAA, 4A teams, and which that doesn't bother me that much. But it's a challenge to put together those games in week six and seven where everybody else is in their region schedule, and it's tough. And if you talk to anybody in the single A that has these small regions, it makes us to have to travel more, you know, when you pick up the non-region games. So once the dust settled, I really like our schedule. I like, you know, we have a tough schedule, and so I like it, but it was hard. It took probably 4 months to put that together, where in the past I could have it done before Christmas. We already had it verbally done. This schedule was being put in place as late as April, wow, you know, of a year ago. It's hard. And I speak for a lot of us coaches and, you know, especially in our region, there's a lot of conversation. And, you know, I was calling a lot of coaches like who's, you know, just you're trying to find out when they change the regions all of a sudden. It kind of shook it all up again. And so you're calling as many coaches about who they let go. And it was a crazy time. And hopefully, you know, we got new classifications coming out. This isn't to be negative about it. I would not. The GHSA has a tremendous responsibility. I respect immensely the job that they have to do. So, but I know it at single A at our level, when you only had four games, you had to find seven. It was tough.
Time to brag on your players a little bit, Coach. Is there anybody on your team getting big college offers? And on the other side of that, is there a player that deserves an offer?
Yeah. You know, it's been interesting coming back home to Elbert County. We have players. We got some tremendous players, right? And so I knew coming here, we wasn't right on I-85 in Gwinnett County that, you know, at Mill Creek, recruiters stopped by there just to get coffee even when we didn't have players. You know, it's just convenient. And there was a few players there. But one thing we've got to do, we've got a junior class that's going to be heavily recruited. There may be as many as 8 to 10 kids that'll be able to play college football. We're excited about the junior class. A lot of them started as sophomores, really 6 of them started as freshmen. So we have a junior class that you have a lot of players in it from LeChaz Gurley. I could rattle them off: Tyrekus Jones, Ja'Cory Barnett, Javen Hickman. So a lot of our key players. Brady Dickerson's probably the heaviest recruited. He plays tight end. But I tell you, our senior class, and we've already met about this, there's about three players in there. I wouldn't trade them for any player I've ever coached. And they're a little shorter. They're probably not going to meet the demographics. But I can promise you, in high school football, we will win a lot of games with these kids. And DJ Rayford's one of them. Miguel Rodriguez is a corner. And I smile when I talk about them because I love them to death. And but they're not going to be heavily recruited. You know, Miguel's a corner that's probably 5'6". But he started for 2 years for us. He's led us in interceptions the last 2 years and just – a tremendous player. So, you know, what I've loved about being home at Elbert, we've got kids that want to be recruited. We promote them. We had three sign last year, but what I love about it, Elbert, is that it's not the end all be all. And these kids really, and I fought this a little bit in Gwinnett County, like enjoy your high school experience. People lose that in recruiting. You get so caught up into what's next. Like, these are the best days you'll have in football. And no. We were fortunate enough, we've had former players come back and talk to our team about that. Like, you better enjoy and grow where you're planted now. And so I've loved that here at Elbert, where we can talk recruiting and all, but honestly, I do have the sense our kids just want to win on Friday nights and let that take care of itself. So I appreciate you asking, because I got some seniors that I think I would love to sign them, but I get it. I understand how it works in college.
Yeah.
Well, and at the same time, you mentioned going back home, and you brought Dyer with you from Archer, so he could just go and hang out at the lake. And you know, it's like he's like, okay, you practice, or I'm going to the lake. But you mentioned what it's like to be home. And for you, you know what it's like. The conversations that we have about the Granite Bowl and what it means to the fabric of high school football and being up there, for someone who's never been to that particular part of the state, if they had a conversation with you about what it's like for you to be back home and what community means to Elbert County football, how would you break it down?
You know, I would tell anybody, if you're from a small town and you ever played and you think it doesn't exist anymore, they're wrong. We still have it. You know, Lincoln County, we played at Lincoln in 2 years. They have, you know, when Dyer, you say this because when Dyer came last year, our first game we hosted Hart, then we went to Madison County, then we played at Washington Wilkes. And I know across the state, those names may not, who knows what those names mean, but they are packed stadiums, no tracks. You know, the fans are right on top of us. And after we played Washington Wilkes, Dyer looked at me and said, "This is crazy." And I said, "I know." You know, I can remember in 7A, we'd play for a region championship in November and it'd be 1,500 people in the stands, you know. And these small communities and these towns, and I'm really sharing about all of them, are so special. But then you talk about the Granite Bowl, and I tell anybody, if you love high school football in the state of Georgia or in the Southeast and you've never been to a game there, you're selling yourself short. It's that nostalgic. I'll use that, especially in our bigger games when we play hard or we have a playoff game and our community shows up. And I'm getting chills talking about it because it's why I'm here. And part of what I've done with our kids is now that I've been back, like, I've coached in big places. I have, but nothing is more sacred than that Granite Bowl. And our kids have really bought into that pride. And we do more practices there. We try to go there more. You know, it's off campus. It's in the middle of town. But and I'll tell anybody visiting, the parking is terrible. Mm-hmm. There's nowhere to park. The concessions are terrible. But it's just like if you go to Fenway Park, and those bathrooms are terrible. The layers of paint at Fenway and Wrigley, you can see the layers of paint. Well, the Granite Bowl is the same way. But we do have new lights. We have nice seats, so it's a beautiful place. But I would tell anybody that just wanted to go back in time 30 years, we have it. And we're going to hold on to it. That's exactly what we want. And I know I'm fortunate to again, have coached at many different places. And I probably have a different level of respect for it just because I've been to a lot of other places. But it's a special place. And I can promise you, myself, our coaches and our kids and our community do not take it for granted.
Last question for you, Coach, and it's our bonus question. Do you have a funny coaching moment, funny coaching memory, game day tradition, or game day superstition you'd like to add?
Yeah, I always said this, is that when we opened Mill Creek, when you start a program from scratch, you could write a book on the things that, because you're getting kids who have never played and parents who have never been a part of it. And I'll never forget the first time we issued equipment at Mill Creek, brand new school. You know, we didn't have anything. And you're really dealing with some of the ninth graders that had to come to you, but your juniors and seniors are kids, I'm telling you, the majority never played football. They just wanted to try it, which that was perfect. But when you gave those kids, and here, and let me just say this, and it's in Dyer's on the staff, it's Josh Lovelady, it's a lot of Jed Hodges, a lot of prominent coaches who have come in from established programs. Well, we issue the equipment and send the kids to the locker room, and, you know, we think the job's done, and we tell them to try it all on and all. Next thing I know, I got a coach sprinting in there to come find me. We had a mama who came in the locker room that was trying. We had two mamas that go to the locker room trying to help their kids size, but they would put in, they were putting like thigh pads in different places, and I'll kind of leave it at that. They didn't even know where to put the pads on their body, and it was really one of the funniest things. I didn't even get mad at the mamas. I just started laughing because we learned then don't assume anything, you know, one, to keep the moms out of it. But the kids were reaching out to the moms because they were just wanting to get help to get dressed. But when you hand football pads to a kid that has never put them on, there is no telling where they'll put those things in. So it was a lesson learned, I can tell you that.